Good morning. It's Wednesday morning. 2 Chronicles, chapters 25, 26, 27. Please, if you haven't done it already, stop and read through those chapters. And there we're going to be thinking about three kings in succession. Amaziah, king of Judah, followed by Uzziah, king of Judah, and then followed by third son in the line, Jotham, king of Judah. And we're going to see, like we've seen before, good, bad, bad, good, keep shifting around. And I want us again to think about why this is happening. And maybe to help do that, we'll go somewhere completely different this morning to the book of Proverbs. And there's a proverb that was in my mind as I was reading through this, because you hit this idea of pride and arrogance. You see it in Amaziah. He's told explicitly one of his big problems is that he has become proud and arrogant. He's called that by Jehoash, who's the king of Israel, because Amaziah thinks, I've got all this power, I've got all these people, let's go to war. Why not go to war, Israel against Israel, the southern kingdom, Judah, against the northern kingdom, Israel. And Israel in the north comes and says, listen, you're like a tiny little thistle, we're like a big cedar. In fact, we're like a wild beast. Stay at home, because don't think you're better than you are. You're about to get thumped. And the reason you're going to get thumped is because of pride. Now, what is pride the precursor to? Pride comes before a fall. Now, immediately when you hear that, you ought to recognize that that's good biblical wisdom. It comes from Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 18. Pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. And that's exactly what we see in these chapters, because they've begun so well. Go back to chapter 25 as it begins. Amaziah is 25 years of age, and he does what is right in the eyes of the Lord, but not, according to verse 2, wholeheartedly. He has a divided heart. And in fact, that's not a bad way to think about what arrogance is about. A heart that thinks too much of itself. It's not steadfast in its love and devotion to God. And Amaziah does so well. You read through these first few verses and you see all the things that he achieves and does, and it's tremendous. He even listens to God's word, and he actually suffers a great financial loss when he dispenses an army that he's paid for. He loses 100 talents that he's paid for these troops and sends them away. And even those troops will turn around and actually bring devastation upon him. But then we see it all turn. Verse 14, Amaziah, who has up to this point been listening to God, brings back the gods of the people of Seir. He sets up an altar and he starts worshipping. Then now the word of God comes to him and he rejects it. He won't listen. In fact, he mocks it. He has the prophet standing before him and says, wait a minute, have we appointed you as an advisor? So you ought to be quiet and leave my presence. He then goes and listens to his own counsel. And in doing so, he thinks he should go and fight against Israel in the north. And that will come to his destruction. Why? Proverbs 16, verse 18, because pride goes before destruction. In fact, verse 5 of Proverbs 16 tells you that the Lord detests all the proud of heart. Be sure of this, they will not go unpunished. And he is punished brutally, comes to his destruction in the end. And that's a warning, isn't it? A warning to us to think about our heart and whether or not our heart is wholehearted or this divided and arrogant heart. Well, what about his successor? Chapter 26, you meet his son Uzziah, and all looks wonderful. In fact, better. You see him establishing, you read through these chapters of what he does. We're told in verse 4 that he does what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father Amaziah had done. He sought the Lord. In fact, he's about to listen to his instruction, and it brings great success because God gives him that success. As you read through, you read how God helps him, how his fame spread. You read how he builds towers and establishes the city. We discover that he does all this livestock and planting. He's someone who loves the soil, weird little phrase. And there you see Uzziah being able to have this great army and all of the things that he's able to do. However, verse 16 of 2 Chronicles chapter 26, but after Uzziah had become powerful, his pride led to his downfall. He was unfaithful to the Lord his God, and he entered the temple of the Lord to burn incense. There's an incident where he goes up, and instead of the priest, he is the one who's going to be bringing this sacrifice, this incense offering. He's warned about that, but he ignores the warning, and immediately he breaks out in a leprous condition that he will have sustained for the rest of his life. And because he has leprosy, he's unclean. He can no longer even go into the temple, into its presence. And he lives outside the city, and it'll be his son who will succeed him and lead. And then you come just briefly in chapter 27 to the reign of Jotham. They're described for us. He's one who will do right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father had done. And then interestingly, we're told, but unlike his father, he did not enter the temple of the Lord. It's also true that during his reign, the people continue to worship other gods. But Jotham's reign is distinctive because in verse 6, we are told that Jotham grew powerful because he walked steadfastly before the Lord his God. Three kings that we've thought about this morning. And I just want us to see that actually Proverbs 16 would be a helpful chapter to read against these chapters. Because in all of this, we're led to think about who we might listen to and whether or not our hearts are full of pride, recognizing that actually God detests the proud of heart, but actually he's one who searches our heart. Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 2, all the person's ways seem pure to them, but motives are weighed by the Lord. In fact, you read on and you realize that this is a chapter that gives great instructions to kings. Kings are meant to detest what's wrong, and their throne is established through doing righteous things. Verse 12, the king takes pleasure in honest lips, the value of one who speaks what is right. But yet in these chapters, we realize that kings actually don't want to listen to the prophets as they come. They want to do their own things. But when kings do listen to God's word, they are indeed rewarded. Had only these kings read through this chapter, they may have been greatly helped. Proverbs 16 verse 29, a violent person entices their neighbor and leads them down a path that is not good. Well, that's exactly what we see in this chapter. Better a patient person than a warrior, one with self-control than one who takes a city. Well, that would have been incredibly helpful. There is a way that appears to be right, but in the end it leads to death. And that's been true in this chapter as well. In fact, had these kings, and should we want to be wise, we would have done well to listen to verse 3 of Proverbs 16. Commit to the Lord whatever you do, and he will establish your plans. The times that we see that attitude adopted in these chapters are the times that we see prosperity come, lives preserved, and the times when we see people ignore that, we see destruction. It's another proverb that immediately springs to mind, isn't it? To trust in the Lord with all of your heart and to lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him and he will direct your paths. And yet we see a proud heart in these chapters. And do we see a proud heart within us? Well, as we come to these chapters this morning, let's heed these warnings and let us be wise, recognizing a God who might lead us in a way that is everlasting. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, would you give us wisdom as we look at our own hearts, as we look to these chapters and see pride at work, and we recognize that perhaps pride is one of the hardest things to see within ourselves. So, Lord, would you help us to investigate our hearts this morning? Lord, would you lead us in a way that might surrender that idea that we know best, that we would ignore your word, that we would reject the great King who might guide us. So we come this morning and wanting to commit our lives again to you wholeheartedly, Lord, that we would ask that your plans would be established and not our own. Lord, would you help us to surrender the throne of our lives to the King that we can trust? So we come humbly. Lord, we don't want to come full of pride and arrogance, but that we would come to the great King Jesus and surrender our lives to him. Lord, would you lead us that we might commit our ways to you? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.